Board of Trustees to order. It is 7:02 PM on Wednesday, November 16th, 2016. Diane?
Diane, please
take the roll.
Linda?
Here.
Karen?
Here.
Barbara?
Here.
Rob?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Patty?
Here.
Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we start our regular business today, we have two special agenda items. And one is because we have a new library president of the day, Fiona Ray. So congratulations, Fiona Ray. Doing a wonderful job so far. Great, great job. So let me just say, so that everyone understands exactly what happened and how this transpired. It brings me great joy to announce that we have received more than 100 entries for our first ever Library President for a Day contest. So that's a big deal, right? Many students in schools located in the library district participated, even a small group of homeschooled students. The contest was open to students in grades K through 8. Students had to fill out a form explaining in 5 to 10 sentences why they should be Library President for the day. The perks of being President for the day are as follows. You are recognized as the November Board of Trustees meeting, so here we are. You receive a key to the library. This is amazing. This is our first key to the library. What do you think? I'd say it's pretty impressive. You have reserved seats to a special Sunday of your choice. You get to pick out books, movies, and music for a display in kids' space in your honor. That's awesome. Choose a family movie to be shown on the library's big screen. So I had the great opportunity of being one of the judges, along with the library director, Susan Lemke, and Youth Services, Arianne Carey. Arianne, it's right here. And Public Relations and Marketing, Sasha. Sasha here? Okay. So we all had a little hand in picking you. It was very hard to choose one winner for the contest because there really were so many great entries, and that's really true, there really were. One entry stuck out for all the judges, and that entry is the winner of the Library President of the Day contest, and that's you. Please give a round of applause to Culver School fourth grader Fiona Ray. Hey, Fiona, do you want to read your entry out loud to everyone? Okay, you go, girl.
Dear Niles Public Library, if I was president for a day, I would help people find books. I would make a book drive to people who don't have books and give them a library card to the library they live closest to. I would make the vending machines in the eating area healthier and fill them with things like granola bars and veggie chips. If I became the library president for the day, I would help the library place books that have water or food damage. I love reading. I am even in battle of the books. I would make the computer searches for books easier and have a wider selection of categories. I would help people if they had a problem with one of the computers, since I am very good with computers and troubleshooting. I am very good with call numbers, so I can help people find their books easily. I would help the staff organize their workspace and help them with other things as well. Even if I don't become president, I will still think of ways to help the library.
On behalf of the Niles Public Library District Board of Trustees and all of our staff, it's my pleasure to award you this plaque with a key to the library. So, great job, Fiona. Ray, you're awesome. President Fiona Ray. So here, want to stand up, see here? Who would, yeah, sorry, not sure who you want to have here. Stand by me.
Oh my gosh.
Can you lunch with a teacher just by yourself?
Yes.
That's great.
Nice.
Can we get a picture of Fiona with her family and also with the superintendent of our school?
Oh, that'd be great. It's like you're standing in your old office.
I think you can come up with that.
I think her teacher would.
Hang on one second, we're getting out of the way.
All done. One of the co-creators here.
It's a lot of pressure, isn't it? I'm feeling a lot of pressure.
Okay, wait, maybe you want with me some also.
Yeah, come on in.
Oh, okay.
Teachers, wow.
Really nice. John.
I also have one with.
Yes, you can get judges.
Thank you guys.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Well done.
Congratulations, darling. What do you say? Great job, President Fiona. Thanks for coming, everyone. Thank you. It was very special.
Yeah.
You bring in the class and chat tomorrow?
Yes.
Right, that's cool.
Congratulations. See you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Okay, our next agenda item will not be quite as fun. Judy?
Took your thunder, Judy.
There you go, come on. How much more fun can you get? So here we go, library audit.
Thank you.
2016, that was such a great key. So cute.
Does it open it? After hours?
We just found which door it was. There must be.
Barb, remember this?
Oh, yeah.
You did make some dents in there.
Yeah, it looks pretty, well.
It was the old table.
Those are some great memories. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, everyone.
So nice to see you.
I'm Judy Walther, for those of you that don't know me or remember me, but I was the audit manager on the audit this year and have been for a number of years. I understand you have already had a chance to review the draft, correct?
Yeah, I was wondering before we start, is it the same or are there changes?
There's one wording change and a footnote. Yeah. We added two words. Otherwise, okay. it was pretty much in final form.
It's material.
Yes. Material. So, starting on page 1 and 2, that's the independent auditor's report, the most important part of the report. And we have issued an unmodified opinion. I know that sounds negative, but that's actually good. If it's modified, it means it's modified and has exceptions. So what that means is the audited financial statements are fairly presented in all material respects in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. So if there were any issues, we'd have to give explanatory paragraphs and that sort of thing, and it wasn't the case. So shifting to page 3 through 5 is the management's discussion and analysis section. It's a high level look at the statements. It's also the only place in the audit report where you will see comparative numbers. So looking on page 3 under financial highlights,
The net position as of June 30, 2016, was at $24,252,000, which is an increase over the prior year of $683,713. So what that means is, on page four, give you a little more detail there. It's a condensed statement of net position, so here we start our comparative look. Current assets compared to prior year are up about $1.2 million, 10%. Current assets is made up basically of cash, investments, and accounts receivable. Current liabilities is made up of your accounts payable and various accruals. And that also is up slightly from the prior year, about $120,000. So what that does, it results in net position of the $24,252,000, and that is broken down between net investment and capital assets of $12,034,000, restricted net position of $459,000, that's primarily your special revenue funds, and then unrestricted amounts of $11,758,000. So net position's up about 3% from the prior year. Now that bottom part of the page is your condensed statement of activities, looking as a comparison to prior year, property replacement taxes up about $800,000 to be expected. That was the increase in the levy from 2014 to 2015. Interest income is up again this year, carrying investments with higher yield. And you'll see the grants are down. The per capita, as you know, was cut from 1.25 to 0.71 cents per head. Nonetheless, total revenues are at $7,025,000, which is up from prior year. Expenses, on the expense side, personnel, you're up about 8%, $240,000 from the prior year. And employee fringe benefits are about the, they follow the same pattern, they're up about 10%. It's tied to the personnel. That other line is all your special revenue funds and comes down to a total expenses of $6,342,000. That from your revenues is how you arrive at the $683,713 surplus in 2016. Any questions here? Okay, page five. Now that top table is your funds as you see them, or as you saw them, at June 30, 2016. So there's no funny business, full accrual accounting kind of thing. This is your modified accrual, which you you should have seen in on your June 30 statement. So that being said, looking at those funds, the increase and decrease, the general fund had a increase of $1.2 million, and I guess significantly due to the property tax levy. Your other funds, you'll see most of them are in a deficit, or you're spending down your fund balances. So on a modified accrual basis, your surplus is $815,000. And under budgetary highlights, the general fund expended $5,183,000, which was well below the legal spending limit of $11 million that was appropriated. Okay, if there's no questions, I'll direct you to page seven. As you get further back in the report, you get into more and more detail. This is a columnar format showing your major funds, general fund and the special reserve fund. All of your special revenue funds are in that other one column. And then the adjustments are adjustments to get to full accrual. The statement of activities on the far right is a full accrual presentation. And what I wanted to highlight here is looking at your end of year fund balances in the general fund. You're at $7,423,000. If you take that, take your total expenditures, it's just a rough look at how many months of expenditures you have in your fund balance. At 2015, you had 14 months. At 2016, you had 17 months. So a little bit of an increase there to be expected. The other funds, going the opposite direction. You had 18 months at 2015, and that is now down to 8 months. So yeah, at some point in time, I don't know what the plan is. I don't know that we ever really talked about this, whether you're going to reduce those down and then pay for those
expenses out of the special revenue funds?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've deliberately been spending them down, and under levying in those funds, mm-hmm. so that we could spend the fund balance down, because the limiting thing about having fund balance in the special revenue funds is that you can only spend it for that specific purpose. So audit fees, for example, sorry Judy, audit fees can only be spent on audit, and it doesn't make sense to have multiple years of audit fees built up. So what we're trying to do is get it down as low as possible, and then by levy, replenish every year so that we're as close to zero, less than 1 year's worth of expenses, certainly. And it's not really an exact science, but we can get pretty close.
Okay. Starting on page 8 of our audit report, all the note disclosures to the financial statements. Note 1 is your summary of significant accounting policies. Weren't a lot of changes here. It's all good information. I encourage you all to read it, but we will move on to page 12, which is note 2. So this is a disclosure of all your cash deposits, investments, and investments. You'll see the investment section has been expanded quite a bit. Not quite a bit, but a little bit. And all of those investments are described on 12 and 13 with the weighted average rates there in the columns. And if you compare these to prior years, your yields are a little bit higher than they have been in the past. And that explains that interest income increase. And then flip to page 16. Note 11 is a new note this year. Something's defined as a subsequent event if it occurred after year end but before we issued the statements. And it really needs to be a significant event as well to require disclosure. So on August 1st, the district began participating in the ICAPREF fund. So this, because of the impact of the potential net pension obligation, it's a huge range depending on how many people buy their past service, but the range of $800,000 to $3 million. So it's a huge number, but because of the significance of it, we felt it was important to put in there. So next year, the audit report will be expanded by 5 or 6 pages because of your participation in IRF. It by itself is a 4-page disclosure, and then there's 2 required supplementary schedules as well. So that'll be an interesting year. And then the last thing I want to point out to you is on page 20. This is a 3-year look back at your property tax levies, your assessed equalized valuations, your tax rates, tax extensions, collections to as of June 30 on that levy. And that's not an exact science because, as you know, in Cook County, you collect, there's objections that, impact things for 10 years. So essentially, doing a little bit of calculation, your 2013 levy, down at the bottom, you've got uncollected taxes of $225,000, and take that as a percentage of your tax extension, and that means you have not collected about 3.6%. We call that loss in cost against the levy. At 2014, it's up a little bit, 3.7%. So we've been seeing an upward trend over the years, so heaven knows what 2015 will hold, but hopefully it doesn't continue. to become, you know, too much more significant than that, but you just never know. Yes. Are there any questions anybody have? Yes, sir.
Could you talk a little bit about note 9 on page 15 and the adjust funds and how that relates to the balance sheets we see all the time and how your balance sheets are a little different?
Okay.
Could you just talk a little bit about that?
Sure. And I can't talk about it without you also having a hand in page 6. On page 6, your modified accrual basis accounting is those first four columns. And all that means is that you're looking more at a current resource focus, whereas a full accrual takes into account fixed assets, long-term assets, and long-term liabilities. So that's what the adjustment column does. It takes your modified accrual balance sheet and adjust, you'll see the biggest adjustment is the capital assets. Adjust it for that as well as compensated absences, that is considered a long-term liability. So,
vacation. Okay, fine, but that's considered a liability, yeah. Because those people are actually eligible, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right. So, that adjustment column then on page 15 is it's described in just a little different format here, but your long-term assets are the $12,034,000. Accrued compensated absences, accrued vacation is a subtraction of $174,000 because it's a liability. And then the reversal of the deferred tax levy. That's that $3 million. It's recognizing the full 2015 tax levy in revenue.
Your statements.
On a full accrual basis. Well, it's not our statements. They're your statements.
Well,
and this is
the
these statements. Are your policies.
So,
yeah.
Okay.
It's capturing
that. Prepared, yeah.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah. So that's a big swing. That you know, recognizing that entire levy, which you haven't even collected the second installment on, you're recognizing that as revenue. But that has been your policy for as long as I can remember. So, but that's those are the adjustments to your modified accrual statements. And that's the balance sheet side. And then the income statement side is like described in that paragraph underneath on page 15. And then that paragraph description is related to the adjustment column on page 7. Okay? That's your revenue and expense statement. So basically, like in the expenditure section, all of those reductions of expenditures, those are capital assets that were pulled out of those line items because you can't expense and capitalize at the same time. You can do one or the other. So on a full accrual basis, you would reduce your expense and then capitalize it in the balance sheet. I know, it's counting, it's 501, it's not 101.
Okay.
But anyway, that's the explanation.
Is that typical for your the balance sheet you prepare to include those types of assets,
yes,
and expenses by
the
local government body not to do that,
right,
in their expense sheets that they typically prepare? The
exactly. This is exactly typical. It's called a government-wide look is what it is. Governments tend to, they're very budget-based and levy-based, so they tend to not really be too concerned about depreciation, which is a non-cash item, and capitalizing assets. They're more concerned about the cash flow of things. So that's why very typical just to have your books on a modified accrual basis. And then the audit is required to reflect it on a full accrual basis. Okay. We get all that information from Greg, though. Greg gives us all of the accrual adjustments and all those modifications to get things out of the accrual basis. And that is why you do not receive a management letter. There's no material weaknesses that are to be disclosed or discussed were brought to the attention of the board.
How many years?
Let's see.
Yes.
How long have you been here? 3 years?
How long have you been here?
Well, the first year, did you?
How long have you been here, Greg?
Three cycles.
Yeah.
So the last one you issued was for 6/30/2013, which was closed right before I got here.
Right.
But for 14, 15, and 16 now.
Okay.
We've done away with the hatch.
Those were interesting days.
Are there any questions?
Do we need to levy more for the audit fund, because it's gonna be much more expensive in the future, because we're gonna have all these extra pages? Okay, I'm sorry.
That's not for me to say.
Tim, Carolyn?
I'm good.
Okay.
Okay. One other thing I have, and I'll let, Susan, I'll let you pass this out, as you see fit. And here's extra copies of the audit, as well as the annual financial report is in the yellow. And, yeah, you need to do some signing on it and return some things to us so you can e-file essentially.
Okay.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. Nice to see you again.
Yeah.
Good to see you too.
Okay, we will now go on with the regular board meeting. First, the approval of the minutes of the regular board meeting of October 19th, 2016. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second. And Karen. Okay, any amendments? Diane, please take a roll.
Barbara?
Here.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yeah, same.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Is there any registration for the public comment?
So we do.
Oh, public comment, Mr. Martin?
Hey, me.
Hi.
How you doing?
Sure. Can I come in?
Sure.
Thank you. So just I'll just say a quick thing. When addressing the board, speakers are limited 5 minutes to the registered individual, and I'll be 30 minutes, so.
Yeah.
All speakers must maintain a professional demeanor. Our first speaker is Dennis Martin. Thank you. You're welcome to sit in the audience afterward and we'll refrain from.
Okay.
Yeah, thank
yeah.
you very much.
Yeah, thanks. So I wanted to come today because I heard a little bit about IMRF, and I know we had a lot of discussion about it several months back. And at the time, I think there was a lot of folks that had recommended that we not go forward with that. And we actually have moved the meeting from this room downstairs in order for people to attend the meeting and there just wasn't enough space. You know, there's a lot of comments saying, you know, we don't think it's a good idea. We don't think we should raise the, you know, have the increase in the tax. And you nicely heard the comments, but went ahead and did the IMRF anyways. And at the time, I'm surprised that somebody didn't look into what it was going to cost. Because nobody said anything about the range of money that was involved in doing it. It's kind of disappointing because I run my house on a budget, and I know at work, you know, we have, you know, phrases like act like an owner, treat the money like it's your own. And we're constantly looking for ways to cut back and save. And I'm just disappointed at the recommendations and the continued process of going down a path of spending more money. IMRF is just one aspect. I think over 6 months ago, I mentioned about the brochure that gets sent out 4 times a year. And I said at the time, I said, I know for a fact that we can print this on plain paper and reduce our costs. And at the time, I heard somebody say, well, we would look into that. But I'm still getting the glossy brochure. Again, you know, it's they all add up, you know, after a while. You know, it's all these costs. And I find myself, driving an 18-year-old car because, you know, I have to live within my means. And I just recently saw that you're selling the old van that used to tote books around. So I'm assuming that you bought a new van. And again, in the business world, how we would handle that is we would push that effort off onto the people that needed the books. So if the nursing home wants to have 10 books for that particular period, they would send somebody from there to pick it up because, you know, we operate in the business world with the funds that we have, and we just don't keep on adding on additional cost. And it just seems that there are many situations where we don't take that second or third look to say, well, what can I do to keep those costs down? And as I get towards retirement, I'm going to have to quit my job. And I'm going to have to work on an even lower budget than I'm working on now. So I just would recommend that we try to make a concerted effort to try to keep those costs down. Look to where we can involve, you know, if the other facilities want those books, you know, they could send a worker to come by and pick them up. I'm not sure what the maintenance for the van is or the cost for the new van. But at some point, there's a lot of nice to haves, and then there's, you know, and I know everybody should be able to get use of the books. My mom was in the nursing home. And I would certainly appreciate her getting those books. But at the same standpoint, we have to look for creative ways to say, well, you know, we can't afford to do that. Can you guys send somebody to pick those books up? They should be able to handle the responsibility, just like if they were to check out a book for their own personal use. So I'm disappointed to see the size of the IMRF. I wish we had looked at it a little harder and considered some other options. I think people are going to be very surprised that as it gets talked about a little bit more. I think people are going to be very surprised at the cost. So.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay, for the month of October, revenue was short on budget expectations by $79,000 for the month. We're still ahead of expectations for the year by $240,000. Salaries for the month are $5,500 short, 2%, short of budget estimates by $70,000 or 6% on the year. Library materials for the month are $19,000 under budget or 31.1%, and $32,000 over budget or about 13% year to date. And this is due primarily to annual subscriptions that we pay in total for the year, and we'll catch up by the end of the year. Library operating expenses are $8,300 under budget, or 26% for the month, and $34,000 or 27% year-to-date under budget. This is due primarily to still spending in the software and per capita line items. General administrative expenses are about $2,000 under budget estimates, or about 9% for the month, and $29,000 under budget, or 30% year-to-date. And this is due primarily to slow spending in the consultant line item. Employee fringe benefits are tracking with salaries, are about $13,000 under budget, or approximately 17% for the month, and almost $28,000, or 9.4% year-to-date under budget. The numbers reflect the IMRF for the month of October, totaling a cost of $18,840. Utilities are within $2,000 of budgeted expense, both month and year-to-date. And the net surplus, or net deficit, for the month is, the net deficit is $432,000, which is slightly favorable to the budgeted net deficit of $439,000. And $490,000, almost $491,000, favorable year to date. If you have any questions, you have any questions.
I have one. Fringe benefits are under budget, $13,000 for the month, and $27,000 under year to date. Is that what that says?
Yes.
Okay, but salaries are short $70,000, meaning what? You're over budget. Is that what that means?
No, we're short of budget, under budget.
So you're under budget for that as well. Okay. Yeah. I was wondering why one was going up and one was going down. Okay, makes sense.
That would be
right, thanks.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
I was going to ask a question about balance sheet. I just wanted to know on page 8,
yes,
the liabilities, we have accounts payable, then we have accounts payable, friends of the library. What
do you owe the library for $21,000? These are the amounts that are due to the friends of the library traditionally for the book sale. It accrues at about $1,500 a month or so. You know, it goes up and down. So there's a few months in there.
So these are books that are donated to the library?
These are books that are either donated to the library, or they're taken out of circulation and then they're put on the sales shelf and they're sold.
They're sold here in the library by our staff.
That's correct.
And then we turn all that money over to the library?
We have in the past. Yeah, it's been, that's customarily, that's what we do.
Can we stop doing that or not? Can we keep the money?
Or a portion of it? Oh, well, I did check with the lawyer, and in the past, we weren't able to do that, but the laws have changed, and we could do that if we wanted.
Would you look into that, Susan?
Certainly.
Thank you.
And just in terms of other liabilities, if you know what that is, you know, it's not specified on the sheet.
I think it used to be that we couldn't because we're a nonprofit.
Right.
Okay, but if the laws have changed, that would be to our advantage because we are collecting it and then we have to hand over the money. That doesn't make a lot of sense.
Well, then we have to answer.
And then we have to beg for the
how
money.
How they want to spend it.
Right.
And we're doing all the work. So.
No, I agree. I mean, if it wasn't the staff that was manning it, it might be slightly different.
Well, if it wasn't donated to the library, too.
Well, more so, I think, in my view, is that we're paying the staff to run it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and I think historically the Friends actually did used to run the book sale. It used to be a twice a year thing. It used to be a huge endeavor.
Right.
They had kind of an army of members. It was a big deal at that time. But that has changed now, and now the Friends are not.
See, if we were running it like Glenn Bridge,
where Bridge too,
they only the Friends of the Library volunteers run it and deal with those books.
Yeah.
But here it's not like that.
Right.
The Friends have to build up their membership. There's no question.
And it would be a little bit different if we had some control over what they spent things on, if they requested to spend it on such and such and we agreed to it. But it just seems completely out of our control. Leaning towards
no sense.
Agreeing with you on that.
So are you taking back some money from them?
Oh, there's, you know what, the camera.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
I'll follow up with Carol.
Okay. So anyway, yes, Susan, if you can, that'd be great.
Thank you.
Okay.
Question?
Yeah, any more questions?
Well, I just asked about the other one. It makes sense to start here, so you can really start at it.
Yeah, I can. Other liabilities relates to the retirement incentive program. If you remember, employees.
A few years ago.
Yeah, employees could take health insurance for 3 years, or they could take, a bonus.
Okay.
And one person took health insurance for 3 years, and this is the remainder of that liability. So it'll be gone after this year.
All right, thanks.
And also maybe next month, maybe you can put that on the agenda, at least as a discussion about the funds.
Okay.
That would be helpful, if you get enough information to have a discussion. Any other questions, Rob, Tim?
No.
All right, thank you, Greg. I will entertain a motion to approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $196,980.79.
So moved.
Sorry, oh, wait.
Oh, sorry.
Payroll expenses of $254,616.47, and special reserve expenses of zero, for total monthly expense of $451,597.26.
You still second.
Barb and Patty. Any discussion? Okay, Diane, please take the roll.
Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Okay, director's report.
The library has been a busy, busy place over the last month. Kind of crazy, but in a good way, all of it. We had the Veterans History Breakfast, and you know, obviously the number of vets are kind of getting smaller and smaller. The World War II vets are not as many with us, but it's honoring the veterans who have recorded oral histories here at the library. And so it continues to be a real highlight of the year. We're beginning to have just a few Korean vets that are in the group, and I just wanted to mention, if you know anybody, Neil has been having a hard time finding Vietnam-era vets to talk with. They typically don't like talking about it very much, so that is something that he is looking for, people that live in the area that are Vietnam-era vets.
Can they live on Park Ridge, too, or do
you know, I don't know that they all live right in the area.
What do they talk about? I haven't been there.
Yeah, the veterans in their oral histories?
Yeah.
Oh, they're really cool. They're actually right outside this door here, yeah. And it's they have talked about their experiences. When they're at the breakfast, they pass a microphone and they just talk for a couple of minutes about what they did, what their, you know, where they were and what they did, and some of their experiences. But the oral histories are fascinating, where they talk at much more length about what happened, and it's very touching.
You can actually get on Library Congress too, and a lot of them have all their documentation, everything is uploaded. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, it has each of the binders out here has their pictures and timelines, and Neil does a fantastic job putting them together. And he's working with a volunteer now who has been helping record some more.
I understand about the Vietnam era vets because of my husband and his friends. Yeah. They don't like talking.
Yeah, they don't.
My cousin's husband. None of them want to
go. About how long are each of your oral histories?
You know, I think it varies quite a bit depending on how talkative the person is and how long, how extensive their career was. But they're just literally right outside this room, and they're just fascinating to look at. I kind of forgotten. It's so vivid, and Neil is so good at what he does because he really does the background research before he talks to them, and so he really understands what they're talking about and can ask really good questions. We also, of course, had the election here, and we set up a table in the vestibule so that we could greet people as they came in, and we could invite them to the Maker Fest. We could hand out this link to the survey. We made sure that the survey was ready to go on election day, and that was a very positive experience, and some people got library cards and stopped and talked with us a little bit. So we really, you know, in a presidential election, you get a good percentage of people coming through. And then We had our 2 days of focus groups, as you know. The second day went very well. You already heard a lot about the first day. The second day went very well also. The consultants were very pleased with the amount of information that they got from the various groups. That was quite a marathon, but it got done. So the next thing after that will be to do the retreat, and that is going to be like a 6-hour event. I told you all it looks like the date that's the most convenient for most of you is Martin Luther King Day. So that's, and is that really not possible for you?
No,
oh, good.
Mike, it's what day is that?
16th.
Monday.
January 16th.
Oh, shoot, then on my birthday. I like when it's on my birthday, then I get my birthday off.
Okay. So yes, please do put that on your calendar, and I will add it to the trustee calendar in my report.
Okay.
And then the other thing that happened was this last weekend, we had the Maker Fest, which was just fantastic. We had around 500 people show up for that, which is amazing. I understand you came to it, right?
Yeah, I had,
right?
I had to park like 3 blocks away.
Yeah.
Just to get in.
Yeah.
So
it was awesome.
Yeah.
It was really great. I felt bad. I couldn't get to it yet.
Yeah.
Especially after I
it was an amazing experience.
I couldn't be here because I had a
It was all kinds of stations. I should have brought a copy if I had it, but they had something like a passport, but it was a circuit board, and as you went around to the different stations, you got a circle that went on your circuit board. It was adorable when it was all finished. And so you could go to the Mosaic station, you could go to the circuit board station. Marianne actually probably knows the stations better than I do, because she's with that people.
We actually, and by we I mean Susan from Technical Services, they formed a group and they went out to the community and invited people from local businesses to come and promote their creative selves. And we had Home Depot, the kids were making a wooden boat. We had Spotbot, which is an area robotics place.
Yeah,
so the kids got to make, I think, like wiggle bots or something.
Yeah.
And we had actually two robotic places. We had a local crafter who did quilting, and they did the mosaics, and they did. We also highlighted creative things you could do with the library materials, like button making, the vinyl cutter. The 3D printer, we gave out free 3D prints, just teeny little tchotchke pieces, but the kids and the grown-ups were like going through them, loving them. It was a really powerful, energetic, exciting day. Yeah.
It brought the whole library, and it was like,
The staff just did an amazing job of pulling it together.
The library has a button maker there. I could say borrow because we bought one for my club.
We haven't sent that out, but we have hosted.
Yeah, because we're making. My club is doing them. Positive.
Yeah.
Things
mm-hmm.
that they're.
We actually had a group. I don't know what high school they were from, but they came and they made buttons for an event that they were doing, and they were passing them out to.
It looked a little difficult. The kids who were helping me,
they
were really using
the
strong arm.
I think it was a big enough success that we will repeat that.
Cool.
There also was the green screen, and then I had our picture taken in front of Vertigo.
I know, there was a little bit of a wait, so
I
was like,
man.
Do
you think Sasha will buy back his bond sign? Or should I just say?
It'll be a different date.
Yeah.
I thought those were very effective promotion, and thank you very much for putting them in your yard. So if you did that. And I think it was a terrific success. And then they are doing holiday pictures, like the green screen pictures here, with holiday backgrounds again next month. So they did that last year, and families made appointments and came all dressed up and did their little Christmas pictures. So yeah, it really just been an amazing few weeks. As a result of that, I do not have an update on passports or the donations that we had talked about, so that will have to come next month. But it's been a great couple weeks.
And you all are going to be at the Holly Jeff, right?
The library is. We have a graph set out, and a staff member is going to go and
manage. It's going to be good times.
Yeah. And then I just wanted to point out that we, again, are a star library, which is something to be very proud of. I think that's a real asset to the community. And if you read my director's report, you'll see that there are not that many libraries in Illinois that were designated star libraries. And then the last thing is that you would ask for information about membership in the organizations. And so to get information about how much it cost and what the benefit was for trustees potentially becoming members. And so I found out that you can join the American Library Association, ALA, for $62. With that, you get a reduced registration fee for the conference and the conference is $62.
Is that per person?
Yeah, yeah. It's, that's much less than it costs staff or people on the field. So it's, they can.
Okay, interrupted you, you get what?
You get reduced conference registration, and I would very much encourage any of you that are thinking about going to ALA this summer, which is here in Chicago, so I really encourage you to go ahead and sign up for ALA. And you also get a copy of American Libraries magazine. If you want to join the Public Library Association, you have to join ALA, and then PLA is a division of ALA. So you would have to join ALA to join PLA.
And that's 62.
That's 62 for ALA, and I think it's 70 for PLA.
And also just, I'm sorry to interject, a side note, when you are a member of ALA, I have like discounts on my insurance because of this professional membership, so you can use it for them.
Thank you. And then the Illinois Library Association is $75 for trustees, and again, you get the reduced conference fee, and their magazine is called the Illinois Reporter. So that's the information. So if you decide that you would like to do that, let Diane know, and she will make sure that you get registered. And that's all I have.
Can I have a couple of comments? First of all, I want to commend you on having an upcoming pizza museum.
That would be fun. That's partly Miss Emily over here.
Good job. A couple of things on the monthly statistic report.
Yes, sir.
Looks green, my last page, 27. What is Green Spa?
It was an outside program, I think, that they hired somebody and you learn how to make the sorts of things that you would get at a spa.
Ah,
so
The Oakton English as a Second Language, 364 people, that's a lot. Are they paying us anything for that?
No, it's a partnership. They are working with some of our community, so.
Do the participants pay Oakton Community College?
No, they do ask them to buy a textbook.
Oh, okay, so it's not a class.
Free.
Yeah, it's not like a class they're taking that they get credit for or anything.
No.
Or it's
no,
not,
no.
They don't write, don't.
I used to be a Tuesday and Thursday evening, 2.5 hours each night.
Yeah, I know what it is. I just thought maybe Oakton was financially benefiting from this.
Tim, I used to be a tutor there, and the tutors are all on.
Yeah, okay. All right, it was just a question.
Sure.
All right. And what's the DS in front of all those programs?
Digital services.
Digital services.
Yes, those are all
in.
Oh,
okay. Well, I gotcha.
It just is a way of flagging.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's right. Put them all together. All right, very good. Well, thank you very much. That's to show you that you know, some of the books at least.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Any other questions? Okay. Can I start in the
I would suggest for everyone to look at the dates and then put them on your calendar so we don't miss anything.
Speaking of dates, I should remind you that if you recall, the December board meeting is pushed up by a week. So it's December 14th, which unfortunately turns out to be when the Chamber Christmas party is. Just so nobody misses it.
Which one?
You voted on that several months ago. Yeah.
Or June, maybe.
Yeah, you said that here.
December 14th?
Yeah.
December
14th.
Yeah. I mean, you can move it back if you want to, but
no,
you have to
no.
do that now, so there's enough warning.
Buildings and Grounds, Barbara.
I don't think there's anything specific.
No, I think that Susan had a little note at the bottom of her report, which I decided to.
Yeah.
About the signage?
Yeah, we just, you guys said that we could hire products to start working on that, so they have started looking at, they took, I guess, a ton of photographs of the building. They did a lot of driving around the building to sort of see what the approach is like from different directions, and they've started to make recommendations of where the signs should be located.
And as far as the bathrooms, you're going to do the ones in kids' space first?
Going to do the kids' space bathrooms first, because the ones up here are a little bit more complicated.
Okay, technology. Liaison reports, Friends of the Library.
I didn't make this week's meeting, so I don't know, Susan, did you make one?
I was not at that meeting either, but I did hear from Rich what they talked about. And it's, there wasn't anything conclusive, just that they have their annual Christmas party coming up on the 10th, I believe, it's Saturday. That second Saturday is.
Oh, is it, okay. And that's when the friends who.
They'll be, they are inviting the volunteers.
They'll be attending?
They're invited, I guess, yeah.
Okay, anything legislative?
No. Anywhere else? There'll be a meeting next month.
Okay, secretary's report? All right.
I have a question about this thing I'm signing here. Am I supposed to vote for one of these people, or?
It is on the agenda, it's one of the motions.
Oh, it's coming up?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Okay, under the new business, I will hear motion to adopt ordinance 16-07, an ordinance levying and assessing taxes of the Niles Public Library District of Cook County, Illinois for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016, and ending June 30th, 2017. Good motion.
So moved.
Wait a second, okay, Tim. And Tim. Greg, is the levy amount that we discussed this month correct?
Yes. Same as last.
Okay. We're doing flat. Any discussion on that? Okay, Diane, please take a roll, starting with Karen.
Karen.
Yes.
Barbara.
Yes.
Rob.
Yes.
Tim.
Yes.
Carolyn.
Yes.
Patty.
Yes.
Linda.
Yes. The next two agenda items concern IMRF. First is item B, resolution 16-02, resolution to cast a ballot in the 2016 IMRF executive trustee election in favor of David C. Miller. Get a motion?
So moved.
Karen. And Karen. Okay, can you tell us a little bit about this election?
So periodically, they have need to replace trustees. There's actually two empty spots right now. One spot you don't see on here because there was one person running uncontested, so there's no need to vote. However, on this particular spot, there are two people who are running. They ask that each member board file a resolution indicating their choice. Susan and I talked about the two candidates, and we felt, for the reason that we articulated here, that David C. Miller was probably the best person of the two to, to represent our interests most adequately.
Who are those people?
I'm sorry?
Who are those people that run for trustees?
They come from retirees. There's retiree slots, and then there's membership slots, I believe. These are membership slots, so Miller works for the North Shore Water Reclamation District. I think that's what it's called. It's right there. So he's the chief financial officer. He's also, so he understands the numbers. He's also served previously on the IMRF board. What is he, North Shore Water Reclamation District, which he works for. So the other person is the deputy highway commissioner for Rockford Township. So, we felt that, without an articulated expertise in financial matters, and the fact that, you know, he's across the state, he'd have less in common with our interests, represents our interests. That's about, you know, that's about the topic.
Those were the only two, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those kind of easy choose.
So the other document is a copy of Resolution 1602, which is filled out except for the selection of David Miller or Brad Trent, or Ryan, if you so decide.
Any more questions? Okay, Diane, please take a roll, starting with Bart.
Barbara?
Yes.
But before you go around, I think you have to.
We can make a motion.
Yeah, well, you know, the motion is that you vote in favor of David Miller.
Right.
Okay, so, I mean, I'm assuming that that's.
Yeah, we're voting for David Miller, right?
Right, okay.
So if someone thinks it, then we are, right?
We have one vote.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so Barbara said yes.
Yes.
Mr. Miller, okay, Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Debbie?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Carol?
Yes.
The next is, let's see, yes, business. Okay, the next item on the agenda is item C1. We need a motion to approve the transfer of $2 million to the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund.
So moved.
Bart? And Karen? Okay, there's a memo on the board packet explaining this, but it might be helpful for Greg to review his reasoning for us. Greg?
Okay, so I made a presentation last time, and if you remember, without any employees buying their past service, we start out with IMRF having an unfunded liability of approximately $858,000. And you can ask how that is, because, you know, we're just starting on day one. On day one, each employee who's eligible for IMRF gets 20% of their experience counted towards their vesting, and therefore toward an unfunded liability, okay? What remains, the 80%, is available for purchase by the employees, okay? We've been keeping track, and when I wrote this memo last week, we had approximately $1.1 million of past service purchased, okay, either outright or an intention to purchase was registered with us. We've asked people what they had done to. That since has gone up to nearly $1.9 million. So when you add that $1.9 million to the $858,000, you end up with about $2.7 million of unfunded liability. If everybody bought all of their past service, it would be $3.6 million of unfunded liability. Okay. So it's like, you know, a natural reaction would be, oh my God, you know, $2.7 million, that's a lot of money. What the implications of having a large unfunded liability are is that we have an interest cost component of our contribution that we're basically taxed, okay? Think of it like a mortgage, okay? You have a $2.7 million mortgage, God forbid. And you're being charged 7.5% as you're paying it down. Everything with IMRF is at 7.5%. Okay. So if the library decides to put $2 million against that unfunded liability, first of all, it improves our funded status. We owe the money anyway. The money that we would put against that liability is only earning about 1.5%, 1.6% at the most. But in the interest of full disclosure, I will tell you that interest rates since the election have increased a little bit. So, you know, now I can max out at about 2%, but still nowhere near 7.5%. And just taking that 7.5% times the $2 million means that we'd save about $150,000 a year in our annual pension costs. This is the same argument that, and it was valid then, it's valid now. This is essentially the same argument we used when we extinguished the bonds in 2012. You had bonds that we were paying a high rate of interest on, I mean, you know, at a relative basis.
Sure.
And we had money that was earning a low amount of interest, so the swap made a lot of sense, you know, to avoid that interest cost, and we end up going ahead. In this case, what the impact would be is to lower our contribution rate, which is currently at 8.12%, to lower it, or at least keep downward pressure on it so it doesn't go as high. You know, if you remember, there's a number of things that affect our contribution rate, including the unfunded liability, the performance of the fund overall, changing demographics, any early retirements or things of that nature. So, you know, what we'll be able to do is exert some downward pressure on our ongoing pension costs. And, possibly, a couple of points lower, but we'll have to see.
Well, Greg, your numbers speak for themselves. What a smart move.
Okay, go ahead, Karen. I had a couple of questions. And that is, just going back in time, I recall, and however, information and PowerPoints during meetings, and I recall you told us about this, that we would, in fact, have initially this unfunded liability that we would have to match. And I do recall, pretty sure you said our maximum would be 3.6 million.
Correct.
So this is no real surprise to us. I understand, Mr. Martin, you have some concerns, but I do recall receiving this information during our discussion. And so now this is what we pretty much expected would be coming down the pike here. I understand that in the memo that we got in our packet, you recommended that we transfer about $2 million to IMRF to pay down our unfunded liability. But what I'm hearing now is that more people have selected the option of purchasing the service, and so that unfunded liability is now $2.7 million. So my other question is, why aren't we transferring $2.7 million? Why are we continuing? Why should we continue to pay interest at 7.5% on that extra $0.7 million? Why don't we transfer this whole amount?
Well, the most basic reason that it came up with is that at $2 million, I'm still comfortable, depending on what comes out of the strategic planning. But if we get much beyond $2 million, you know, I start to struggle a little bit with, being a little more cash poor, if you will, and not having the funds available. Plus, you've heard Judy Walker, year in and year out, refer to how many months we have in the tank, so to speak, how much dry powder we have, should anything happen. So, just being a little fiscally conservative, I enjoy having that cushion just in case. And last but not least, we could always make another contribution down the road.
Well, that was my next question. I hate paying interest. And if we can revisit this issue maybe in 6 months and find if we have the cash to pay down the rest of the unfunded liability and thus do what I think is fiscally smart and not pay that interest,
right.
I would like to do that then. So I presume you'll bring that issue back to us again,
certainly,
perhaps in 6 months for us to address that again?
Certainly. And when we're sitting here a year from now, we'll have much better information,
right,
because everybody that was going
to
act has acted already, so the numbers will be more solid, and that'll be one variable that'll kind of be parked on the side. I want everybody to keep in mind that the balance of the past service, which is not being purchased, okay, the unpurchased past service, can be purchased at any point by the employee up to their retirement day if they retire from the Niles Public Library District. If they, you know, if they move on, or let's say they go across the street to the Village of Niles without purchasing it, they lose that opportunity. But as long as they stay employed at the library, they have rights to go back and purchase that past service. So I don't want anybody to leave tonight thinking, oh, good, 2.7 million, we dodged a bullet, so to speak, and because it's now 3.6. That's not the case, you know, and we won't know until, you know, virtually everybody has moved on or has retired, you know. So this will be something that will be out there for quite a while. Although the likelihood of them acting, you know, years down the road is, I would put it kind of low, because every year that past service cost increases 7.5%.
I have a couple of questions. I recall in June when, during our board meeting, we were discussing IMRF. There were so many questions going around the table, at least from me, and I remember repeatedly asking you, what is it going to cost us totally if we go into IMRF? You told me you didn't know that. You once said we had to have an actuary do a study. Then we had an actuary do a study, but you still told me that you couldn't give us the figures. You mentioned last month, as of day one, we had an underfunded amount of almost $900,000. That amount never came up. You kept repeating. No, it did. I listened to the tapes. It never came up in the June meeting when we were trying to vote on this, when we needed all this information. You gave us great PowerPoints, but when I talked to you one-on-one in front of everyone and asked what would be the highest, what will it cost, I don't have that information. It's just not available right now. So now we need $3 million if everybody buys back previous service. And we're going to need more money if somebody decides to retire, correct? That would be additional costs. Because I believe that was a comment you made in your presentation as well. Retirees would be an additional impact. So what we all need to remember is, what you did say was that it was going to cost us $300,000+. And I remember Karen Diamond saying, oh, it's just $100,000 more than the other plan we had. Well, now here we sit. Then now we sit here today needing another $3 million. Now, what really is perplexing is that there are 44 full-time people who work in this library, 6 who will after 1 year be full-time. We're spending $3 million just to jumpstart a retirement plan for 44 full-time people and some part-time. And now that everyone's buying back all these service hours, what happens to our contribution rate? Does that go up to 13% now?
No, because a large portion of the 13% was due to the more significant or higher unfunded liability.
All right, Karen.
What does that mean?
There's an interest cost associated with the unfunded liability.
Right.
If the unfunded liability increases, the interest cost associated with the unfunded liability goes up as well.
Now, I had a note here that said, based on what service hours were bought, our interest rate would increase to 13%.
Our contribution rate.
That's what I meant, our contribution rate. So that means next year, in 2 years, instead of paying 8.1 or 7.2, whatever we're doing now,
8.1,
it's going to be 13%, which would be even larger.
May I answer this? This is what the $2 million is to prevent. If you pay the $2 million up front, you don't have to pay pay the 13.6.
Then what would our contribution rate be?
There's no way to know.
I can't tell you that.
Okay, but I thought it was supposed to be 13%. That's just.
That was the highest it could be. Remember, it was 8.12 up to 13.2.
Well, isn't Greg the rep for IMRF, so can we let him finish whatever he's trying to say?
I do understand it myself, and I think I can speak clearly, and he has already answered you, so I just thought I would try again.
So it's not going to go up to 13%?
I can't answer it.
Well, then how could you answer it if he can't? He's the business manager.
Well, see, Carolyn, if the fund underperforms.
Oh, well, that's another story. If it underperforms, then we have to put all that back in.
So I can't tell you, I can't tell you what the markets are going to do.
But the 13% didn't have anything to do with the fact that IMRF had another bad year. I thought that had to do with.
It held all things constant with the exception of the unfunded liability. The unfunded liability, if nobody bought, was 858,933. If everybody buys a gas service, it's 3,661,000, and I can't remember the last two digits. So based on that increase, our rate would, just on that increase alone, our rate would go from 8.12% to 13.7%.
Okay, so that is an increase.
The bulk of the increase related to interest. Okay. And the interest is related to the unfunded liability. So if you reduce the unfunded liability, you reduce the interest charge. If you reduce the interest charge, you reduce the contribution.
So then we may not have a then there won't be a 13.1. I get that. I totally understand that. So that makes sense.
If all other variables are exactly the same.
I understand.
You will not get the 13.7%.
Okay.
If they have lost years, or they underperform significantly, then you will maybe be higher than that. I mean, because of the way that.
No, I understand. I totally understand. But I have another question. Once we pay this $3 million,
I think Karen had a question.
Well, can I just finish my conversation with him because I am speaking. So once we pay this $3 million.
But I think if it's related to it, then she gets to speak, and then you get to speak after.
Excuse me, I'm in the middle of a conversation. What is your problem?
Because that's
I am sick and tired of when I speak, you interrupt me and tell me to stop. Or when I talk, you try to talk over me.
This is Robert Rules.
No, I'm having a conversation with him. Is there an egg timer on the table? I'm getting tired of this.
Wow.
How many times on the tape? I will finish. Yes. And how many times when I listen to these videos, I hear you over talking when I'm trying to talk. So please have a little respect.
That's your opinion.
Well, listen to the tape and tell me what your ears hear.
Mm-hmm. Please.
So my next question was, once we've paid the unfunded amount, what are we going to be looking at in terms of monthly payments? We are now at 19,000. Or close to 19,000. Does that drop?
It depends. I mean, as I said, I can't answer that. I mean, that 18 to 19,000,
mm-hmm,
that we pay on a monthly basis is related to 8.12%, which is related to a series of variables that at a stated rate. Depending on what happens with those variables,
yes,
assumes that our payroll is level. Because it's 8.12% of our monthly
payroll. Okay.
So if our payroll increases or if our payroll decreases, there will be an increase or a decrease in the terms of the dollars that we actually pay to the IMRF.
And there's no percentage charge for all these additional service years or whatever that are bought back. So that does not affect our monthly payment in the future.
It does, because it creates unfunded liability.
But we're paying that off.
We're not paying it off.
Well, not
we're my estimate right now is that we'll end up with about $2.7 million. And what the motion on the table is for $2 million. So it'll still leave $700,000 of unfunded liability, which is a lot better than $2.7 million. And the implication of reducing the unfunded liability by $2 million is that you avoid paying the interest on that $2 million at a rate of 7.5% per year,
right,
or $150,000.
Okay, and then I'd like to just mention, I think this is an exorbitant amount of money. It certainly should be something we would have discussed this thoroughly in June. And I feel that you rushed through this process. I really think this is a major mismanagement of funds. It's almost like you had us, we couldn't even have an interaction with each other. You had us say, make our comments, and you couldn't interact with one another. It was the most bizarre discussion of IMRF I've ever seen. That's just one thing. And then secondly, I don't know how you expect the taxpayers to accept the fact that we have less than 100 people and it's costing us millions of dollars just for retirement. And then you have a 3% program, we call it a salary program. Did anyone ever think maybe we should cut raises for a while? Because look at how high our retirement package is. I mean, what are we doing in this library to offset such an exorbitant amount of money? To look at it like it's a drop in the bucket. I mean, at least look at it from that perspective.
Thank you, Carolyn. Anyone else?
Quick question for you, Greg. On page 12 of our audit, we show where our money is sitting.
Right? Yes.
So we're taking this $2 million from some of those funds. Are any of those funds negatively impacted? Are we being fined or losing any?
No.
We don't have any penalties.
That's what I
think. No, there's no breakage. We won't be paying any breakage. As luck would have it, I don't know if you consider this to be lucky or not, but up until last week, there were a number of investments which it's not matured. They called. Okay, so you know some of these agency bonds, you know, they have opportunities to call every 6 months, some of them
right,
every 12 months
right.
or something like that. If they feel that they could reduce their interest, their carrying costs by reissuing the bonds at a lower rate.
Right.
So there was some of that activity going on, and we've had some of them call. And because we were working on this particular motion, I held off reinvesting to make sure that we had money to, if the board decided, to do something. If we decide not to do it, I mean, as I said earlier, the rates have turned a little bit more favorable in the last week, so it wouldn't be much of a loss.
Sure.
Be actually a gain.
Okay. Thank you, Greg. Thanks for asking that because that's a good question. I hate to pay penalties.
Yeah. Or interest.
Yes.
Rob, any questions?
One question. Just somebody who's late to the game. What was the program prior, and what did it cost per month?
The program prior was a 7.5% gift to the employees with the intention that they would invest it in the 457 plan. Total cost was about $185,000 per year. $15,000 a month.
Okay.
So if you look at the costs for the first year of IMRF participation, we estimated that at about $225,000 total. But we started on August 1st instead of July 1st,
right.
So it might be a little bit lower than that.
And the previous program only included full-timers?
Oh, yeah.
Part-timers
yeah.
Included.
Yeah, this includes part-timers in excess of 1,000 hours a year.
Okay.
Anyone else?
I do remember you, Greg, saying during the discussions, and I recall having many discussions about IMRF and going over these figures again and again in different PowerPoints. And I remember discussing it thoroughly. But I do remember you saying on a number of occasions there are certain things you couldn't predict. But I recall those being limited to you couldn't predict what other employees were going to do in terms of whether or not they were going to buy
fast service.
And you couldn't predict what future interest rates were going to be. I don't recall you saying there was anything else you couldn't predict. Other than
mortality
factors,
tables.
Well, okay, mortality
and retirements.
That was it.
It's a lot.
Okay. All right. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Can I ask a question about a budget?
Excuse me, one second, Debbie.
Okay. We, during our budget meeting, or during our meeting for, to approve our upcoming budget, we increased our pension line from 500,000 to, was it 1.5?
2.5.
2.5. What's that for?
Well, at the time we were talking about the budget, the appropriation ordinance, we recognized that there might be additional costs associated with IMRF. And that, and those additional costs might either be related to excessive purchases of past service costs or retirements once folks bought all their past service. And the board decided to add $2 million. That's the other reason we can't spend more than $2 million is because we're limited by the appropriation. And what we could do, you know, if the board felt passionately about it at some point, is increase, go through the actions to increase that appropriation, which would, you know, which would include refiling it and so forth. But we're at.
How long, yeah, doing the increase? Okay. Thank you for saying that. Now I have my question, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
How long without doing this increase would we have to wait before we could add more to it? Another year?
No, you can do it anymore. Well, practically speaking, you'd have to go through another budget cycle.
Okay.
And approve the other budget.
Okay.
And at this point, you know, since we're pretty much in, you know, pretty close to December, it would
be maybe like another 6 months or so.
6 or 7 months. Mm-hmm. We approved, or the board approved the budget in June of this year. Mm-hmm. Okay. And if we held it at schedule, so we're looking at 6 months before we have the authority to spend.
Yeah. You feel that's reasonable?
Yeah, I forgot about that limitation when I asked that question before.
I don't want to do anything that's going to force things to go any higher.
No.
All right.
Thank you. All right, Diane, please take a roll.
Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
I have just one more question for you, Greg.
Wait.
Oh, are you?
Well, we're already done with that, so.
I just have a question for Greg.
Okay, go ahead.
Ask it. Do you see any way our IMRF liability or whatever it is could be reduced? It is all contingent upon staffing, correct? So right now, based on our current staffing, this is what our contribution is to IMRF. Would it ever be able to decrease in the future?
Well, if you paid off all of the unfunded liability, that would exert a downward pressure on it. If you decided to reduce staff or only work with staff that was working less than 1,000 hours a year in total, that would create a greater pool of staff that is not eligible for IMRF. And the simple math would be that, you know, if you lower one of the factors, the result's going to lower.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
All right. The last item under the new business is item D, which is, do I hear a motion to adopt ordinance 16-08, an ordinance determining personal property no longer necessary or useful to the Manistee Fire District and authorizing its conveyance or sale?
So moved.
Barb?
Yes.
And Karen? Okay, Susan, what are we disposing of?
On page 44, you see the list here. It is the computers that have all been replaced in the last year. It's just the computers themselves. It's not monitors, keyboards, things like that. They range from being 6 years old to being 8 years old, and so that is the majority of what we want to dispose of. There also, we have replaced a 10-year-old large-scale printer that is Exhibit B on page 45. It's computer equipment.
discussion?
That is the, that value of $1,000, that's the value, that current value.
Yeah.
Right. Not what it was purchased for.
Yeah, at this age, you know, we'd have to pay somebody to take it.
Boat anchors.
I seem to recall in past years when we were getting rid of computers, we tried to donate them to schools, but they didn't want them.
But we had these already older than those, so, because they have better technology.
Now they're all one-to-one, so they have their own Chromebooks.
Yeah.
iPads.
Chromebooks or iPads, each kid is supposed to carry with them.
Okay, any further discussion, any questions? All right, Diane, please take a roll, starting with Barb.
Barbara.
Yes.
Rob.
Yes.
Tim.
Yes.
Carolyn.
Yes.
Patty.
Yes.
Linda.
Yes.
Okay, we have no unfinished business. Is there any other? Okay, we'll now entertain a motion to adjourn the meeting. Patty? Second? Here. Okay, Diane, please take a roll.
Patty.
Yes.
Linda.
Yes.
Karen.
Yes.
Barbara.
Yes.
Rob.
Yes.
Tim.
Yes.
Carolyn.
Yes.
Thank you very much, everyone.
This is so different than you do.